So before we begin, you know, let me give you a little background. Also have today very important from the alma mater where I studied. I did my engineering from the National Institute of Technology, Kurukshetra. As we all know that every state has an NIT, and these were institutions of excellence which were founded some time back, and during the era, I would say, of Pandit Nehru, you know, those days, and then later on, these institutions have progressed over time, especially during Prime Minister Vajpayee's time. Great importance was given to these institutions first time, and the idea of recognizing the National Institute of Technologies, of course, along with IITs and others, as institutes of national importance began. And I'm very happy to say that we have none other than the director, National Institute of Technology, Dr. Satish Kumar, amongst us. Please give him a big hand. So Dr. Satish Kumar ji needs no introduction. He's a Padma Shri. He's recognized by the government of India. He worked as an eminent scientist in the DRDO, which is the Defense Research Development Organization. And he was involved with Dr. Kalam in the development of the missile program in India. So that is the kind of distinction. So last time when we had Dr. Saab as a chief guest in one of our Indo-Russia meet, which was held in this place itself, you know, that time, you know, it was like very interesting that I had written ki how Efremov, the great scientist from Russia, had a great relationship with Dr. Kalam. And in the relationship, what happened, it actually, I would not use a negative word, but it literally trespassed on any country relationship also at that time. It went beyond that. Because the last physics equation which was required to actually get the missile guided in the right proportion and right way and to hit the targets at the in the right format, I'm making it simple for people who are not in this system, was actually simply given by Efremov to a younger Kalam. Compared, both were senior dignitaries of the world and great scientists par excellence, but it was just given off, you know. It did not need two country relationships for that to happen. So ultimately, whatever we are seeing, the BrahMos development, and Saab was involved in the BrahMos development, and today you see one of the most lethal, I would say, missile technologies in the world. In fact, we must say the most lethal, because after it has come into the Indian hand, it has actually seen the best things happening, like we launched it literally from our sophisticated fighter plane already. I'm not naming it. We are trying with others as well. We're trying to see whether we can reduce the payload, and other engineering experiments are going on. But what I mean to say, this kind of thing, transcends boundaries, transcends even sometimes the country relationship becomes so strong that people's relationships also matter. And it was one of those great relationships. And in fact, Saab has met Efremov also several times personally, and he has been involved with all that. So we are very thankful that we have him as the director of a National Institute of Technology today. So then only the education system in the country will repair itself if we have such people leading the game plan. So we are very happy that we are having him amongst us. He had a very tight schedule. He still said, I'll be here, you know, with you. So thank you for that, sir. And we have many other dignitaries. We have Colonel Khera, who I would say, I must always say, is a friend personal, but I must say responsible for the good part of the telecom. Unfortunately, telecom sector is facing huge crisis. Yesterday, we did not have our, 2-3 hours, our phones were not working. You know, the Mumbai phones were literally not working. After 2 hours it started, I could not even get across my friend from Gujarat, Hetal, who is there. We have also PM Shah, the president of the Southern Gujarat Chamber of Commerce. And it is very ideal to have him, because the Southern Gujarat happens to be the place where you have almost all the concentrated, I would say, development model and wealth of the country. It has also some heavily industrialized zones, including Vapi and Udna, the oldest estate from where Hetal comes, who is going to be our next president of the Southern Gujarat. The vice president and president are there. Happens to be my colleague also in the Renewable Association. We have A.B. Agarwal amongst us. He doesn't need an introduction. You know, whatever you saw, please give a big hand. A.B. Agarwal sahab was responsible for Bhakra. In fact, several times these awards have seen him. Today he will be amongst us encouraging, but he is also one of the Hall of Fame person of the ENERTIA Awards. Thank you for that. And we have none other than Yogendra Prasad. You know, his name should be, I would say, we must be thankful that we had engineers after M. Vishwashriya. I would say we have an engineer like Dr. Prasad, and Prasad sahab was responsible for Indira Sagar, Omkareshwar, all the entire development of the other side of the Narmada, where MP benefited a lot, and he did a lot of excellent work in this country. These projects are, like I tell you, after we say the Hirakud, the Damodar Valley, and all these projects developed in the first stage, the second stage of development, we must congratulate Prasad Saab, and we must congratulate people like our Agarwal Saab to organize and make it efficient, you know, ensure that they function the way they are. Of course, I must say that they all both belong to NHPC in that way. One served as the chairman, the other as an ED, for sure. So we have, and we have amongst us SC Sharma. Can I see him somewhere? Tehri. Yeah, right. So thanks. We have Tehri amongst us again, you know. And Tehri is another great project. Because when the floods happened in Uttarakhand, I would tell you that Tehri ne bacha liya Delhi ko. So wo scenario hai, so this is the way. We have TC Arora, who also needs no introduction, because if you see from the beginning, he has been in the jury in the first award of 2007, you know, and he served Toshiba India and longest serving director. And also I would say, really, if you look at Toshiba, Arora Saab must be seen as a man who had an Indian face for a Japanese company, and probably through him they learned how to progress. And I would say what Toshiba did became the benchmark for the Doosans and the others. The Koreans followed suit, and now there is a trend that we have Indian leadership coming in, but of not of his stature still, because I would love that stature to come, because multinational and transnationals have always one problem, that they somehow they have to increase the value of trust that they repose on the country environment they come in, failing which they always will again have the decision-making board only controlled by their people. So thanks to the environment that Arora Saab created, Toshiba remains what it is even today. It is a company which has always entrenched itself in India. And today also you will see that one award will go to a place where technology is coming from Toshiba, Japan. So we must say thanks to the Japanese, thanks to people like him, that this jury is indebted to people like him being part of it. I have my colleague Prakash Sharma right there. Prakhyat happens to be, see, he's a brother to me, because after today's function is very important for my brother, but more than a brother, a great professional who actually conducted these awards for years together, because he was the invisible hero, because he got all of us together. You know, I barely was the man who was coming here and talking to people, I would say like that. But Prakash was the man who gave the light to people in the industry. Every chairman knew him. Every person, I would say Rajesh knew him very well, you know, so we don't have him. 2015, on the same day, this day, we lost him. And he was the man who was physically challenged, you know, but more than his physical challenge, his mind was a sharp and successful mind. And he had revolutionized, because he had a debilitating polio on the lower limb, which could not allow him to move. He studied from the government college in Faridabad, you know, right near you. And he was not allowed to go into any schools. So till 20 years when he became, the family educated him through a process that he was given all possible help. And at the age of intellectual clash with the then registrar of IGNO, you know, the gentleman was convinced that people like him should be allowed to give an exam in life. And he said, even if you think I am not trained, but I will cross. If I fail, you don't take me in into the program. At the age of 20, Prakash, and he also got help from one more lady whom I must mention, is Dr. Umatuli of Alimco, you know, All India Limbs Manufacturing Corporation. Because we came from a middle class background, so we could not even afford our wheelchairs or anything. So he said that hum to aap paisa bhi nahi denge, aapko pura karna chahiye. So when she knew Prakash's condition, and it was when ex-army doctor who went and talked, Dr. Kapoor, who is no more, and his son became the sub-editor of Business Times in Singapore. They lived in Kalkaji. They went and canvassed. And son-in-law literally brought the wheelchair home. That's it. And Prakash could move in the wheelchair. Then he got the tricycle and used to go and attend those study centers things. But he cleared the exams with 75% plus marks. So his first exam of life, right? And next was this real exam of life was his living itself in all that locomotor deficiency. Because what it does it, it actually merged his vertebrae and he could never sit straight, and 3 or 4 hours he would have to take a rest to go flat, you know. So these were his physical conditions, and it never came in front, but he was a champion. I would say the sector benefited from him, whether the power, renewables, oil and gas, all benefited from Prakash. And the best way to do is, you know, in our orthodox system, we will do a puja, we'll do a lot of things, we'll call the pandit and all that. But in my family, there's a trend. Everybody, don't waste your money on these things. They are more pragmatists. They said, better call people, put it in an intellectual scene. My great-grandfather did the same thing. He said, call five poor people and give them food is better. So I think Prakash also was always of the view that humko ye sab nahi karna chahiye. So what better than name this 11th Inertia Awards after him? So all these years it was called Inertia Awards. So this year it is being called PRAKASHmay, because he sent light unto everybody. He never took anything, he gave only. You know, brother, you know, little older than him, about 1.5 years, but he was the think here. I saw him on the social media, active many years back, and he moved Baluchistan. Can you believe that? He had a crowd which was bigger than what you can see could create. And I remember people asking him, Bhai Saab, abhi hamare yahan bomb phata hai, to kya main bahar niklu ki nahi? You know, girls used to send him messages. So she was feeling trusted. And through Google Map, he would go. And he would tell, he would find all the things out through his own place. And he would say, ki nahi, abhi aapko nahi nikalna hai. 4 hours baad aapne nikalna hai. You know, that kind of thing. You know, so he had a mass and you could convince. You know, he had friends like Dr. Khushwant Singh, who liked him, you know, and because he writed, he started writing for Hindustan Times in those days. So wo number one paper hua karti thi. It's just, zamane mein Indian Express was always number one. Times could never cross Indian Express in Bombay Circle, you know. So these were, Prakash comes from that background, and he wrote for Express. And finally, he literally joined me, and 2007 onwards, Inertia grew as a brand, thanks to him and thanks to his work, no less than anybody. And definitely every professional around us knows Prakash, who has been with us. And yes, I have a very important professor amongst us. If I miss somebody, please pardon me today. But yes, Dr. P.J. Philip, right up there. You know, a professor who taught us at NIT Kurukshetra. He taught us the English language. You know, it's important that communication is a key art. And I'm so proud that we had engineering economics. We had, you know, the first truck with economics happened there. And I feel the cross-pollination must happen in the subject. Aaj wo Tripathi saab keh rahe the, humari education system ka jo, jis tarah se bura haal hai, I think it needs to be relooked, and, you know, we must look at what we are producing, you know, what type of knowledge and affair we are giving. Our people are only oriented towards the job psychosis, or they are out there to do some wonders, you know. And I would say, everything is not money, honey. It's always the other way around. That you must be feeling good about yourself. You must also be respected. You must also ensure ki aapki contribution cog in the wheel na bane. Wo kisi prakar se owners bhi ho enterprise ke, wo kahein ki ye asset hai hamare paas. The asset class hai human capital ka aur intellectual capital ka. Iski hame recognition jab tak nahi karenge, is country mein kuch nahi hoga. Wo hum jante hain. Lekin I think we are I am not a skeptic. I still will look like a skeptic at times, but not. You know, I'm an optimist of the, sometimes they will say, aap wo jyada optimist hain. But optimist rehna bahut zaruri hai. Ek aisa desh hai jo badi mehnat se logon se bana hai. It's an in spite of country, because of to hai nahi. To mere saab se, sabko samajhna chahiye ki everybody is so powerful that his or her contribution will make an India, which is a better India, you know, and for a better world. You know, that's what I would believe. And that's what Prakash and me wrote in the first book, India Brandish, Superpower Brand India, 2003. We thought about the concept. 3 books came at a time. Gurshan Das, India Unbound was there. He's a much more celebrated author. But luckily, the Dombili brothers from a Mofussil, I would say, suburb of Mumbai, like we were from a Mofussil suburb of Delhi once upon a time, from Faridabad. So we became famous in the Times of India. Ki Dombili brothers unlock or unleash brand India. You know, something like that. And my friend, Hindu, I have a grudge against Hindu. You know, because in that, we said, bhai, India realized its brand worth in modern times because of what happened at a time, Sushmita Sen. So a lot of problem with Hindu. Tumne Sushmita Sen kyun likh diya? And I can tell you, even today, if you take up that video where she won the award and then she spoke, I tell you, nobody at that age has ever spoken in the way Sushmita Sen has spoken. You know, many intellectuals will not be able to speak in that manner. Please kindly download that video and see what happened to the first Miss Universe from India. And nobody has come to that level, I can assure you. So they got mentioned in our books, those who So because we try to do our best, we try to recognize people in that book also, what happened. We also talked about our history, and historicity chapter was not my subject. It was Prakash, the way he began, how India contributed to the whole thing. He wrote beautifully, you know. So that book is a must read. We have made it free. Anybody sends me the mobile, I'll send the color version of the book free of charge. We're not charging anything. Three books are free, written together. Third one was Atal Shastra. Khera sahab aaye the. You know, we had the launch on 27th October last year. And after that, I immediately made free. It is on the Prime Minister, whom we appreciate, who wrote a letter to Prakash for the India Brandished in 2003. And that letter remains an important letter. He was more bothered about the health of Prakash, you know. So a Prime Minister who would personally write, you know. So that was Vajpayee ji, and we just had his 93rd birthday. You know, and a great day. He was born 25th. I'm lucky to be born 24th as well. We are children who are born closer to the Christmas when the world celebrates. So happy to be there. But yes, on the same day, today, one happiness is there. But on the other side, today is a day where I will always remember my brother, but a great professional, a great man who only gave to India. And I would say he was an ability icon. The word disability, so if I ever do a book on him, which is going to happen shortly, you know, I would like to call him an ability icon. But disability word hata dena, humne physically challenge bhi hata dena, ability icon, you know, this would be the way I look at Prakash. And thanks to all of the people who have taken time off, and we have a new year time, and the day falls in such a time, but I'm very happy for people who have come. May I request now Dr. Yudi Chaube and S.C. Tripathi to please come over, sahab, to the dais. May I request both our gentlemen to please come on the dais. Tripathi sahab. So that we can have the lighting of the lamps ceremony. And we will also have Dr. Satish Kumar. So we have, I tell you, there is no better time to have people of their caliber on our side. Bansal sahab will be joining us for sure shortly. And we will have Yogendra Prasad ji to join them. Please give a big hand. Bari taliyan bajein. Dr. Chaube also needs no introduction. He is right now the Director General of Scope, the organization where we are sitting, you know, which is grown under him. Recently, we did a, you know, kind of a, I would say, an analysis of 16 people who influenced the sector like nobody did, and both the gentlemen on the dais become very important for us because we are expanding it to a group of 50. And Dr. Chaube was considered by us as the man who gave the gas economy to India in that whole thing. He definitely somebody, and Prasad sahab was also there. So I mean to say, the ones on the dais, you know, a period of post, in you know, freedom, I don't call it independence, I call it freedom for obvious reasons, which I will explain later. But post our freedom day, you know, the people who have set, you know, there was a 15-year, 20 years, I would say, time, then later on what set as an India, there were officers, and it has gone unnoticed or less celebrated kind of model. Aur usme main kehta hu ki Tripathi sahab ka bahut bada role tha, Prasad sahab ka bahut bada role tha, Chaube sahab ka to bahut hi digaj role hai. Aur aaj I'm very happy that we have a scientist of top order, Dr. Satish Kumar ji, amongst us. So these are the people who have transformed. So if I can put 50 people who have transformed India, that would come up shortly. You know, we are working on that. You know, so very important cheez hai. Yeah, and we must recognize this. Not only there is a political leadership for sure every time in the country, but this country of 1.3 billion had a lot and has a lot of good people in it, and we must have the confidence in that whole lot. You know, some of them are sitting right there, they are not here. They must also have contributed phenomenally to the whole cause, and I am happy to have each one here. Arey saab, humne to ek Ajay Nirula saab ko bhi dekh liya. Nirula saab, thanks for coming. So please give him a big hand. Ajay Nirula is, I tell you, the North Delhi Power Limited. And it was Anil Sardana ji, now he heads, you know, Tata Power. Or now, what? I say, Tata Power, he heads it, right? I say, Anil Sardana ki. So they were colleagues. And he transformed that time. And this utility has won many of these awards, the NDPL. Now it is the Tata Power Delhi Distribution. But when it was North Delhi Power Limited, people like Ajay Nirula must be congratulated. Another colleague of his Vadva Sahib is also there, but he's not here. Today we are only Ajay Ji, because I called him, wo aaye, bilkul acha laga, main jinko dekh pa raha hu main aur mujhe nazar aa rahi hai, main bol pa raha hu usko. But yes, we must congratulate people like him as well, because this utility was the first utility that won many of our awards in the private sector. So thanks to all. May request the lighting of the lamp to happen. May request our dignitaries in the dais to kindly come and light the lamp. As I told you, I continue that we had Pankaj Channa and Nikesh. Can we have your hand up, please? They were responsible last year, if I'm not mistaken, to ensure that this body is formed, Pan-NIT alumnus. So we have a Pan-NIT alumnus, National Institute of Technology Alumnus Association, which actually combines all the 30 states, National Institute of Technology. And they are the president, and I believe you are the secretary, if I'm not mistaken. So. Yes, and both the people, the founders literally, and thanks to the NIT Kurukshetra backing that we have of the director. So this Dharmakshetra Kurukshetra has done the job. I would say that. So the battle begins for better education, bettering everything, ensuring that we produce hands-on engineers again, people who can create, innovate, you know, indigenize, you know, whatever we're talking, the Make in India stuff, you know, it will only happen if we have our engineers ready to work with their hands. अभी ए कंडीशन रूम इंजीनियर्स बनने बंद हो जाए दे गो एंड विजिट आवर प्रोजेक्ट्स लाइक प्रसाद साहब कितने सालों से उन्होंने प्रोजेक्ट किए तो इस तरह कुछ हो तो मजा आए तो इट इज वंडरफुल सो बिफोर आई बिगिन द फंक्शन आई वांट टू जेंटलमैन टू गिव अ फ्यू वर्ड्स टू अस यू नो एंड आई वुड स्टार्ट विद द विजडम ऑफ कॉलिंग एस सी त्रिपाठी जी टू से अ फ्यू वर्ड्स ऑन व्हाट इंडिया मस्ट एक्चुअली डू टू ट्रांसफॉर्म द situation that exists for the power, energy, oil and gas and resources area, you know, what we must do, what are the few steps that we must take, you know.
Professor Iyer, distinguished invitees on the dais and friends, I am happy to have this opportunity of sharing my views, since Professor Iyer has given me a subject which is very topical, very important, but also very difficult. So I don't know how to speak on this subject for a maximum of 5 minutes. So what I will do is, I will try to give a historical perspective. Up to year 1500, India had 50% of world GDP. And by year 1750, India and China had 50% of GDP. China had little more than India by that time. So India was slipping backward. And 1947, India had only 1% of world GDP. Today it is about 4%. So I think it, all of us are present here who have been energy professionals, management professionals, education professionals. It is something to ponder and think about. since the Industrial Revolution, about 250 years ago, we developed a model of growth and development which has been very energy intensive. And it is since then that we have been slipping behind, and other countries have been going much, much faster, much ahead of us. So access to energy resources and harnessing energy resources became the most important factor in the growth and development of countries. Even today, as I say that we have 4% of world GDP, though we should have 16% per capita, we are still in GDP, 1/4 of world's average. So that is the same ratio that we have in terms of per capita energy consumption also. So we have a long way to go. We, of course, do not need to follow the model that came with Industrial Revolution. We have to be more energy efficient, and the source of energy also can be little different. We need not be so dependent on fossils. We have to increase our capacity for renewables, where hydro is a very important factor. I see two giants of hydro projects, hydro energy present here. And I keep telling various assemblies and various gatherings, whosoever is willing to listen, because I was associated at one time when I was in Japan in late 80s with the funding of Narmada project. And both Japan and World Bank stopped Narmada project, and at that very time China was developing Three Gorges Dam. They didn't care for anyone, went ahead and put up the project. I have also been associated with NHPC in recent past in some capacity, and I find that they have no new projects, because somehow in this country to get anything done is extremely difficult. We are all very capable people, but our efficiency, our capabilities are somehow utilized in negativing anything that is happening, so that the net result becomes big zero. And that is what we need to think as to how we can go forward bringing about a consensus, because without consensus you cannot go forward in this country. We are a democracy. We don't have the luxury of countries like China and others who don't have such active parliaments, such active judiciaries, such active NGOs and such active civil society bodies. So we have to harmonize and build consensus to move forward. Whether it is thermal plants, hydro plants, renewable plants, we have a long way to go. We need to continue our work in all directions, because I feel that the renewable plants cannot become the base load plants. We cannot depend entirely on the renewable plants at this moment, at this point of time. When I hear our leaders speaking about energy, they make two points. One, that we have become energy surplus, we have become power surplus. I don't know from where they have got this point. I have contradicted on national TV and media so many times. It is like Mr. Moily said some years ago that we are likely to become exporters in oil. So I said it is not the fault of Mr. Moily or the Minister of Power who has now shifted. I said it is the fault of their advisors and their secretaries who don't seem to interact with them well enough to tell them the real picture. So therefore we need to interact with the politicians and the media also. I find that many professionals are very hesitant to deal with the media and deal with the politicians. But this is, whether you call it evil or whatever, it is a necessary evil in an open society, in a democratic society like us. It is much better that you interact with them rather than they get interaction from some others and have their own notions. So we have a long way to go in energy. Unless we provide energy, unless we access energy resources, harness them, our growth will not take place on the desired lines. I see here many educationists, and Professor Iyer, you are a professor, so I have another suggestion for you. You are organizing very good conferences on energy and energy related issues, but there is one subject where I think there is a great need for an integrated or national forum, and that is education. We need to have an India education forum, like we have India Energy Forum and such so many other energy bodies, which harmonizes the views of the various stakeholders. I find in the energy in the education sector, elementary education is dealt with somewhere else, school education somewhere else, higher education elsewhere, technical education elsewhere, medical education somewhere, and vocational education. Either it is the teachers, or it is the parents, or it is the students, or somebody else, but there is no forum which harmonizes all views, and it is very necessary that we should harmonize and develop a policy for education, and not only develop, we are good in policy making, also very poor in implementation. Implement them, because the population that we have, it is a raw material. It becomes a finished product through the process of education skill. If we do not provide them right education and skills, then it will become a great liability rather than an asset. So I will suggest to Professor Iyer and all those who are organizing these conferences to also think about education and organize a forum on education which brings together all stakeholders and gives input to the government for policy making. I find that the present government is interested in doing something, but I see that it is going from one committee to another committee to third committee, and perhaps they are going in circles. So they also need inputs from bodies which have harmonized the views of all stakeholders. I don't wish to take more of your time. I wish the organizers also all the best. Thank you.
Thank you, Tripathi Saab. We had Tripathi Saab as both the Petroleum Secretary and also the HRD Secretary, because I was not remembering, so we got a little bit of, well, you know, positive flack that we forget his HRD stint and during the tea time, and that is a good one. And I feel what he said is right, because it has to begin back with what we are doing with our education system. And I would now request Dr. Chaubey to say a few words, you know, before you know, the other people speak, because Chaubey Saab also has a lot of things to say. He's an erudite author of several books. So, and those books are path-breaking, the books on the public sector. They are must-read, you know, so I would like Dr. Chaubey to say a few words.
Good morning, everybody. Sri Sit Tripathi, former Secretary of Petroleum. Sri Prashad Ji, former Chairman of NHPC. Satish Ji, and dignitaries on the dais, invitees, my colleagues from SCOPE, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, I do remember that in mid-80s, when I moved from industry to industry as a deputy manager in Gas Authority of India, it was very difficult to let them know that LPG is not natural gas and natural gas is not LPG. That was the condition of the country at that time. And the only contribution that today, everybody has been talking about MMBTU, BCA, BCT, and whatnot. So actually that part has been a contribution. Leaving aside that, after having passed almost 45 years in and for public sector enterprises in India, I realize now that if there is a list of accused who did not contribute anything towards gas economy, I become equal partner. gas sector has been really a victim of wrong projections, wrong assessment, policy paralysis, and whatnot. Before coming, rather 2 days before, I had asked my colleague to prepare a list at what were the projections and what were the achievement in gas sector. And the figures which has been given to me based on the authentic data, whether it was PPSC, Petroleum Ministries, statistic, or all authentic data, it has been alarming, and that's why I tell that we are equal partnered in not bringing gas to the extent required towards the contribution for economy in the country. In 2008-09, when Sir Tripathi, you were Secretary of Petroleum that time, the contribution of, and I was Chairman and Director of Gas Authority of India, of course, the contribution of natural gas in the energy basket was around 9 to 10%. It is now brought down to 6%. ONGC, which was producing almost 80 million cubic meter of gas a day from domestic sources, their now supply is around 48 million cubic meter of gas a day. In between, there must have been a huge investment on gas exploration, production, and all that. We probably could not learn from the reality. As some of the figures I will quote, you will be surprised to know that when it comes to projected demand and actual gas available, 14-15, it was 405 million cubic meter of gas a day. That was the projected demand which was projected by all of us. Prior to that was also similar story. But actual things which came was 131 million cubic meter of gas. Projections 405, actual 131. 2015-16, 446, we could not learn from the previous year, went on in projecting the demand, and actual was 143. 16-17, 473, actual is 152. Now come to production. At least we know what is going to be produced next year. But the projections are alarming. There is no synchronization of reality and the utopia, to be very frank. 14-15, 192 demand. And actual availability was 92 million cubic meter of gas. 15-16, 200, actual was 88. 16-17, 232. We are not learning from previous year. And the actual came down to 86 million cubic meter of gas. We could not learn from this and went on unabated, confusing the entire gas sector and the consumers of the country. Actual availability in the last 3-4 years, you just see how it is going. Against a demand of 256 in 2014-15, we had 142. 15-16, 306, we could not learn from previous year, and actual was 146. 216-17, 359, against that 154. And the new exploration and licensing policy, which continued for so many years, Of course, there was nothing new for continued so many years in NELP. There was no incentivization for attracting the foreign bidders to explore the gas in the country. And the figures, once again, is the witness of our policy paralysis. I will not take from early years, but NELP 7 number of bids received were 181. Foreign bids 21, came down from 35 to 21. NELP 8, foreign bids came down to 10. And the last, that is the ninth bidding round, which is over, 10th is likely to be in January. The foreign bid has been brought down to 8. And investment, in terms of the US million dollars, 815 in 7, NELP 7, brought down to 439 next round, and meager 119 million US dollar in the last round. We could not learn to incentivize for attracting the foreign bidders. And now we have started talking that the natural gas will be 15% in energy basket in few years' time from now. If we are living in fool's paradise, there is no other way. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.
With that very modest position that Dr. Chaubey has been taking on the gas economy, I remember the gas economy meeting. First, I did it in Gujarat in 2009, when Hetal and me, remember, we had none other than Pandian and the Saurabhai Patel, the minister in Gujarat, doing it. The second big meeting that happened after many, many years was in the chairmanship of S.A. Tripathi ji, jo hamare madhya hain aaj, hamare beech mein. So, main ye keh sakta hu, sir, bilkul with good conviction, कि गैस और हाइड्रो की जो बात है ये वापस अगर इसमें फोकस नहीं किया जाए एक तरह से मीडियम टर्म एंड लॉन्ग टर्म गोल्स पे तो देश की इकोनॉमी का भटा भी बैठ सकता है सो ऑब्वियसली आई विल आस्क योगेंद्र प्रसाद साहब टू से अ फ्यू वर्ड्स बिफोर आई गेट अवर यू नो अरोड़ा साहब ऑल्सो टू से अ फ्यू वर्ड्स एंड फाइनल वर्ड वी विल हैव बिफोर आई डिस्कस अबाउट इस डॉक्टर सतीश जी थैंक यू फॉर एवरीवन एंड मैं कह रहा हूँ मॉडेस्ट हैं चौबे साहब पर जो किया गया है वो एक बेंचमार्क है और दोनों दिग्गज यहाँ बैठे हैं हमारे बीच में
राकेश जी त्रिपाठी जी चौबे जी अरोड़ा जी डिस्टिंग्विश गेस्ट एंड अवार्डीज डॉक्टर अय्यर हैज कॉल्ड मी टू टेल समथिंग इन द पावर सेक्टर आई हैव स्पोकन मेनी टाइम्स एंड आई कैन टेल यू वन थिंग और एक्चुअली I can say the ruler of our country do not understand what is power. Actually, the power is not being understood by top bureaucrats of our country. Certainly, we can't expect that from politicians. Today, we have more than 3,30,000 megawatt of installed capacity in this country. And every politician, most of that we have surplus power, we are going to give interruption-free power to all the villages. Unless the fundamental of power sector is understood by the people of our country, it cannot happen. Our goal of the nation should be that power should be available to everybody without any interruption at proper frequency voltage. 99% of the people do not understand the meaning of the frequency. It is a simple thing. Whatever power you are generating that has to be consumed, then it will be, in Indian system, the frequency will be at 50 hertz, and the best quality of power you can get. In spite of that, we are not understanding the fundamentals that whatever energy is being generated, generator is under the control of the nation, but consumption is in the hands of the people of the 130 crore of our nation. So certainly, the mix of power has to be designed properly. In spite of the fact that we have 3,30,000 megawatt of the generating capability, 60%, and as a result, all generating companies mostly are losing heavily. Even organization like NTPC, which was most efficient organization in this country, what is happening today? Their, if you examine their profit margin, it has gone down. Their PLF has gone down. And because of the old plants, they are getting priority. That's why I say they are surviving, they are in the profit. But if you compare from the older days, they are naturally losing every day. And the time will come, it will be a very difficult time for India to come. Now just see, we are not having proper distribution system. Whatever you are generating, we have to transmit, then we have to distribute. Now, for transmission line, also capacity decided that 132 kV transmission lines, how much megawatt will go. For 220 kV, how much megawatt will go. Similarly, for 33 kV, how much megawatt will go. What will be the requirement for the LT lines? In villages, you are not getting power at proper voltage, though there is regulatory order in the country. In every state, the variation in the voltage should be not more than 5%. In LT side, the regulator says that below 380 volt and beyond 480 volt, 420 volt, the power should not be supplied. But how many people are getting? They are getting 180, 200, 300. I have seen the villages because I am moving in the village. And nobody motor works. That the fundamental people are not understanding. For that, power generation is very much required, proper mix. Now just see, 1 lakh megawatt government is planning to have solar power without having any thought over it. Because for that, we should have the pump storage. Once I questioned the Piyush Goyal sahab when he was minister in 2015, then he told, no, no, Mr. Prasad will discuss in the meeting, in the office. He would not reply. I mean, what is going to happen in this country? You have so many pump storage schemes of more than 95,000 megawatt in this country investigated much earlier, in 1960s. Until date, we have developed only 4,000 megawatt. Similarly, the reservoir projects, we have developed hardly 20,000 megawatt and more than 80,000 megawatt development capacity is required, available in this country, which was investigated in 1960s. Today, may be much higher. What we say? Power demand, when the power consumption takes place, it demand comes immediately. Then you need the generator which can cope with the power so that the frequency you can balance near 50. Now grid code has been implemented in this country. As Tripathi was saying that 8 to 10 times power cut is there. Power cut should not be there because there is national grid in this country. But DISCOM companies, in order to save their loss, because we are giving power supply at fixed frequency, and frequency is never fixed. It all depends on the demand and supply. Then when that frequency is low, DISCOM companies are going to lose heavily. As a result of that, they are disconnecting the power. They have no other solution. And the fundamental of the power sector as understood by the people of our country. Even I have seen during my service career also, and I have gone to many IITs, given my lectures, I have question answers, and I have seen that even 90% of the power engineers also do not understand this frequency business. What is this frequency? How generation takes place? Whenever you are going to generate power at low frequency, high frequency, the efficiency of the generator gets damaged. Then a lot of expenditure is there. Now, today regulation is there. In 2014, that, as per the regulation, if your frequency is 50.05, the generator will get no money at all, as per the regulator order. And when the frequency goes beyond 49.9, then generating cost is very high, that the DISCOM company had to pay 4 rupees or 5 rupees, and then after add the cost of distribution and other things, then the tariff will come to 8 rupees or 9 rupees. But consumer is going to pay 5 rupees. How the that DISCOM company will survive. These fundamental problems should be understood by the people of our country. Otherwise, things will not improve. Today we are having 3,30,000 megawatt above generating capacity, but we are not meeting the power requirement. And there is regular cut of power everywhere in the country. Everybody knows. But whenever the politicians give lecture that there is no cut of power, they have surplus power in this country, nobody will question them. Simply, whatever they are saying, we are hearing. But things are not improving. And as a result, our economy is getting affected like anything. On this, I have written one article in 2012. And I have given to that time that Sindhya Sahab also. That health of Indian power system and its impact on Indian economy. And I have given threadbare everything about power sector. But nobody was believing that. After that, after my article, 30 days after that, there was a collapse in India. Of the 2-3/4 of India was without power for 3 days. So this is happening because of, without understanding anything. Even I have seen when I was in the USA, in 91 for training, I've seen that if you need 2 kilowatt of power, that we offer to the committee whether distribution line will take the load or not. But here we are having long distribution line, long transmission line, without making any study. Somewhere it is over voltage, somewhere low voltage. We don't have the meaning of the quality power at all. If people go to the court, every day there will be injunction. Because we have made the law, but we are not following at all. This is the fate of the country. So we need immediately the development of pump storage schemes and reservoir schemes so that the generating plants or thermal power plants are used to the full capacity and we could improve our economy quickly. Okay, thank you.
This subject has been dealt by Prasad Saab for quite a long time. And I think we have made also several representations. I was astounded that I have, through my records, what we have represented, Prasad Saab, I want to tell you, has been incidentally taken, and my name was listed in one of the Prime Minister's committees, and that I will share with you, where they have sent that paper for at least 2 discussions. You know, and these discussions have happened on hydropower's problem, but unfortunately it seems we have come to a dead end, where next 2 years to hum kuch nahi kar payenge. Short-term goal nahi hai iske. Iske ab long-term goal rahe ki ab hume dekhna hai, कि अब हम 11 या 10% हमारी शेयर हो गई है तो देर इज नो कैपेसिटी टू प्लग एंड प्ले बिकॉज द गैस पावर प्लांट्स अबाउट 20 गीगावाट आर लाइंग आइडल फॉर वांट ऑफ गैस इवन द बिगेस्ट प्रोजेक्ट ऑफ 2184 मेगावाट इन दबोल व्हिच इज द फेमस एनरॉन यू नो दोज हु हैव नॉट कम फ्रॉम दैट टाइम आई कवर्ड दिस प्रोजेक्ट लाइक एनीथिंग आई वॉज इन फेवर ऑफ द प्रोजेक्ट एंड आई वॉज नॉट इन फेवर ऑफ द कंपनी एनरॉन के खिलाफ थे क्योंकि ऑब्वियसली एनरॉन एक ढकोसला ही था अल्टीमेटली So that, usko chhod dijiye. But as a project, the 2184 megawatt project was a very important project for Maharashtra. And I remember the then planning member planning commission, Madhav Godbole, ended up telling the Maharashtra needs no more power. Wo yehi baat hui thi surplus power ki. Ki country mein surplus hai, aur humara to surplus ho gaya. Famous mistake that made Sharad Pawar later on to admit that we were wrongly advised by Madhav Godbole that no more power was needed after Dabol. And it was a very foolish idea ki a population of a state with about 12 crore, they said they don't need any more electricity. And you cannot believe that for 10 years, the ex-minister, was Dr. Dilip Valse Patil, and Dr. Patil recently celebrated his 60th year, and I was called in that massive function. He still has a grassroots support, one of the very soft-spoken ministers from belonging to the Nationalist Congress Party. But he said, वॉयर साहब हम आपके वो डिस्कशन में सब यूज टू बी ऑन द सहारा चैनल ए 50 गीगावाट एमओयू प्रोजेक्ट्स वर इंट्रोड्यूस एंड नन केम अप मैसिवली उनके प्रिंटर प्रोजेक्ट्स वेंट बैक टू द स्टेट गवर्नमेंट फाइनली महाजन को हैड टू डेवलप द भुसावल्स द नासिक एक्सपेंशन एंड अदर एक्सपेंशन परली वैजनाथ एंड ऑल दैट बट इवन टूडे आई एम टेलिंग अ स्टेट लाइक महाराष्ट्र विच इज माइंड बॉगलिंग 40 गीगावाट वी हैव इंस्टॉल्ड कैपेसिटी And neighboring, I would say Gujarat is also matching up. Gujarat installed capacity is 30 gigawatt. And population of the state of Gujarat is 6.5 crores. Now I would say 6.6 roughly. Maharashtra is 11.8 crore. I must tell you the third one, interesting one. UP is 22 crore population. And the index, capacity index for Uttar Pradesh is not more than 10 gigawatt. Ab aap isse samajh lijiye kya skewed development model hai. कि आप जब अपनी इकोनॉमी को ड्राइव करने के लिए आप दे ही नहीं सकते. एंड दैट इज वन ऑफ द रीजंस दैट महाराष्ट्र टुडे इज अ कंट्रीब्यूटर अबाउट $400 बिलियन ऑफ द जीडीपी इज गोइंग टू कम टू 350 बिलियन क्रॉस कर चुका है. मुंबई अलोन कंट्रीब्यूट्स 150 बिलियन एंड मुंबई एंड दिल्ली बिकम्स मेगा आई वुड से कंट्रीब्यूटर्स बिकॉज 125 बिलियन कम्स फ्रॉम द एनसीआर एंड एमएमआर रीजन कम्स 150. वी डोंट रियलाइज द इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ कंजम्पशन एंड इकोनॉमिक्स. यू नो दीज टू मॉडल्स whatever criticism we have for them are the largest consumers and drivers. And if you see globally, companies also end up establishing themselves in the national capital region or the MMR. So if we don't understand this fundamental driver called energy, power and infrastructure, we will never come up. One of the things is ki wo battery operated vehicles so 100% is country mein aa jayega. Already, you know, my colleague Tyagarajan is here. His own builder, who is a local reputed builder, his son has bought a 6 lakh rupees में उसने मतलब वो अपनी महिंद्रा की गाड़ी ले आया है वो 6 lakh में. एंड देन ही सेज आई प्लग इट इन फॉर 2 hours एंड आई कैन गो ऑन फॉर एंड इज वेरी हैप्पी विद द व्हीकल. तो जो हम हाइब्रिड कार की बात कर रहे थे एंड वी आर टॉकिंग ऑफ नाउ कार्स विच कैन ड्राइव ऑन द रोड विद यू नो इलेक्ट्रिक ड्रिवन और आई वुड से हाईटेक मोटर ड्रिवन. सो इंडिया विल बी डेफिनेटली द अर्लीस्ट कंट्री टू एम्ब्रेस दिस. बट वॉट आर द रिसोर्सेस राइट. This is our, I would say, completely skewed thinking on the planning system. अब आप देखिए कि even waste management में भी हमारा वही हाल है. Waste management में अभी देखिए बहुत अच्छा Prime Minister का thinking था स्वच्छ भारत all this. But मैं आपको बता सकता हूँ, I have seen Delhi, I have seen Bombay, I have seen all this. Even I have seen, I would say Raipur is doing better than us. I would say Lucknow may be better than us. You know, we must come to the facts, hard facts. Bangalore, Mumbai, which is MMR, Delhi, NCR, they look like pathetic cities, you know. They are really suffering with dirt. Wo koi nahi utha raha hai. You know, itni waste management ka kaam kar liya, lekin wo kachra street pe fekne ka kaam to chalu hai. Aur uske upar se kya hai ki hum ye blame karne lage logon ko. Aap logon ko blame kariye, wo apni jagah hai. Lekin municipal corporations kar kya rahi hai. इनके यहाँ तो अब जेसीबी से अब निकाला जा रहा है. जेसीबी से थोड़ी उठाया जाता है ये कूड़ा करकट जो है वो, क्योंकि पर आवर जो है जेसीबी का रेट ज्यादा है और कंपेयर टू वो छोटी सी हमारे बॉम्बे में उसको घंटा गाड़ी कहते हैं आप किसमें वो छोटा व्हीकल आता है 4 times 5 times a डे आ सकता है इन एनी स्मॉल स्ट्रीट इट कैन कम. तो हमारे यहाँ प्रैक्टिकल थिंकिंग खत्म हो गई है. तो वी विल बी फेसिंग अ लॉट ऑफ क्राइसिस बिकॉज ऑफ आवर इनएबिलिटी बोथ पोलिटिकल एंड इन अ पब्लिक डिस्कोर्स वेयर मीडिया आफ्टर मीडिया माई ओन कलीग्स हैव फेल्ड दिस कंट्री. Every evening they run a charade, kind of an exercise, which is, I call it the cockfight and bullfights, which have nothing to do with the country. So unless, and that's the wisdom me and Prakash had when we talked about media. If I get an opportunity, I'll go digital quickly. Anyway, Arora sir, your words and quick words.
Thank you, Professor. Mr. Tripathi, Mr. Chaube, Mr. Satish Kumar, Mr. Yogendra Prasad and Mr. Bansal, and ladies and gentlemen, of course, everything has been said about the power, and I don't need to repeat it. But I would like to touch on 3 things. One is, for any sector to develop, you need to have a policy, you need to have a technology, and we need to have a finance. These are 3 pillars. And from 1991, when the reform process came, we continued to put pressure on reforms and bringing the policies. There was a fiasco of double power. We brought the regulators, then Electricity Act. And since 2003, there have been so many regulations and amendments that policy has done certain good things, but also made certain things very complex, especially on the distribution side and transmission side. Things have become very complex. Industry was given as a motto for power, or the other way, electricity was considered to be an industry, which means you need to make profits. Any industry which is, has to sustain has to have profits. And the policy was a little confused, sometimes saying reasonable returns to the prevent project developers and consumer interest. Now these things are contradictory in certain areas, but nevertheless, we don't want to criticize the policies, but I would say that there's not been any consistency. Every year there's a change, and considering the gestation period of hydrothermal, by the time the product comes, you come to know that it is not that viable what it was thought of. Similarly, we are seeing in renewable. Although people are objecting to that kind of megawatts, what has been proposed by the government, but then if I see the power sector and demand of electricity, it is variable. I have never seen any country having a constant demand of power all the time. 24 hours, it has to be variable. So similarly, if the demand is variable and if input can also be variable, the technology has to come in to play an important part to match the two. Then comes the finance. Of course, when you bring policies, you bring technology, you bring also finance to create more competition. We see in the price discovery, the prices of solar has gone so low that whether it is viable or not will be seen in the coming years. In the end, I would say that in spite of all these competition, viability and policies, Professor Iyer has been with us 2007, and we had been thinking about the people who have been contributing, maybe small in quantum or large, but we must recognize them. And that is why we are sitting here today. Thank you very much.
So we have an excellent jury, and it has done a good job all these years. And with the request of Kumarji to say a few words.
Dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, Professor Iyer, the organizing committee members, other dignitaries, distinguished guests, my fellow colleague, and the president of NIT Krukshetra Alumni Association, Professor Pankaj Channa, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning to all of you. It's my pleasure to be present here this morning. I am confident that through the School of Renewable Energy and Efficiency, we will be able to contribute our bit by carrying out research and technology development that would have relevance to the renewable energy and industry. I am particularly happy and drive a sense of pride, in fact, that one of our distinguished alumni of NIT, Mr. Professor Iyer, is the key person working in the domain area and is the man behind this event of the great significance. Today, as you heard from the various dignitaries and the experts in the field of power and the energy, that the major portion of the energy demand is met by the fossil fuel. Considering the adverse impact that the use of this energy source has on our environment and diminishing fossil fuel reserves worldwide, therefore, there is a need to make the appropriate effort to find the alternative source of energy and the solutions that are environmental friendly and able to meet the ever-increasing demand of energy. Government of India has also identified the renewable energy sector as one of the critically important areas for the country and is putting a lot of emphasis on exploring the renewable energy source. Our ideal goal objective should be a world power by 100% renewable energy by efficiently, using it by efficiently and wisely and make it accessible for all. In fact, the effort what Professor Iyer has made towards the renewable energy is really remarkable. And there The new effort in the direction, I was discussing with Mr. Mehta also in the morning, that they are spreading it towards the academic institutes also. Already in Gujarat, they have opened a center worth 60 crore in one of the engineering colleges. This is a remarkable initiative. And similarly, last time Professor Iyer, he visited NIT Kurukshetra. There also we had a discussion and we have a possibility to work on the similar type of collaboration and to develop such kind of a more centers. Basically what message I want to give and which I learnt from my experience in the missile program in the country. I started working my younger days with the late Dr. Kalam. See, there are three factors. One is the attitude, second is the skill, and third is the knowledge. Unless we have these three factors strongly, it is difficult to have the sustainable development. So, I remember if I go past in the 80s, when we started that missile program in the country, we were nowhere. Only we had some basic fundamental knowledge of the missile systems. And in the further coming years, by putting the, he laid those foundations, foundations of the attitude, foundation for the skill and foundation for the knowledge. And in the right proportion, to develop the industry also. Basically, in those days, we did not have any industry for the missiles. And in the introductory remark, Professor Iyer told that we had later collaboration with Russia to develop the world's best supersonic missiles called BrahMos with the help of the visionaries like Formos. So those kind of a model, which we have already, it is successful, and we should use in the power sector also. For many problems, the experts, they have told, there are various issues are there in the power, and we know that the fossil fuel will not be there. Maybe after 50s, there may be some problems, issues. We may have to depend on the renewable energy. So for renewable energy, we should try to evolve a good model so that we can really have the self-sustainability. And for that, I clearly see that we should have a very close interaction and tie-up with our R&D sector. If we don't have, we should develop. Unless we have the latest technology in the renewable energy or in the oil or in the gas sector, the proper scientific manpower who should think of that what will happen after 20 years, after 30 years. That is absolutely essential. Those kind of the R&D laboratories in the country. Second thing is their connectivity with the industry as well as with the academic institutes. We have excellent institutes in the country like NITs and the IITs and the various other private universities also. They have come up in a very nice manner. They have a good resource. These institutes, we should see that they develop the proper manpower, required manpower to develop the proper industries. Industry need good people, good designers, good testing agencies, and the good manufacturers. So we have to do that. Unless we have this close connectivity between the R&D and the academic institute and with the industry, we will be discussing the same problems, maybe another 100 years. So we have to have the first, the right attitude, the people with the right attitude, and strong connectivity of the industry and the academic institute. The industry should go to the academic institute. Our real brain is there, I can tell you. I experienced in the last 1.5 years in the NIT that our BTech students, they are really wonderful. great minds, if you just go and tell your problem, industry, go there, discuss with them, directly with the students, they can really solve many problems. They can give many innovative ideas, which we can, with the help of the startup or the help of the any other way, it can be. We can really develop the good products. So this collaboration, unless we do, so it will be, we cannot succeed. And Professor Iyer and his team with Mehtaji and others, they have really taken this step forward, and I'm sure that in the future it is going to grow much stronger. They will reach to the other NITs, IITs and the good universities in the country, and certainly I'm sure that one day our country will be self-sufficient in the power, and everybody will have 24 hours power. Thank you very much.